Hello everyone, this is Yoshimi, and welcome back to the channel. We've covered a good deal of creepypasta content on the channel throughout the past year, so why not take the time to cover a good deal of creepypastas that you may remember and be nostalgic for with a creepypasta iceberg. This video was written by collaborator and fellow YouTuber Time6, who was kind enough to give me the script he had written so that I may present to you some of the most terrifying, mysterious, and downright evil stories from across the internet. Time6 also runs a channel known as Maverick Files where he covers all sorts of strange topics, and I was even featured on an episode a couple months ago that I recommend you check out. Time6 makes amazing content and deserves a lot more attention for the time and effort he puts into those videos. I also want to thank Reddit user Avargus for creating this iceberg. While researching the iceberg on my own, I did notice there was an updated version of this iceberg that they created with new entries, so I will be covering some of the other entries in another bonus video since I was unable to cover them here tonight. That being said, let's dive into the depths below as we cover the creepy pasta iceberg. Russian Sleep Experiment. Written in August of 2010, the story tells of a post-World War II science experiment gone horribly wrong. What starts off as a simple concept of keeping soldiers and prisoners awake turns into a disturbingly gruesome story. Sonic.exe. We all love and adore the famous Sega franchise Sonic the Hedgehog. So Sonic.exe was supposed to be a simple children's video game enjoyed by a diehard fan, but it ends up turning into something more twisted and sinister. Once the game was played, an ancient evil being would take over the game and begin killing the characters via gory deaths within the game itself. And finally, the Eldritch Beast would turn on you, the player, as his last victim. Herobrine. Minecraft, a calm video game limited by your own imagination. What isn't possible in this game? Build houses, make farms, mine diamonds, raise animals. The original post started on 4chan's V-board, with an anonymous user asking what exactly was going on in their game. This would be the first time the spirit would be given the name Herobrine. What was supposed to be a simple game is now supposedly haunted by the dead brother of Minecraft's original creator, Notch. But don't worry, Herobrine doesn't exist, he isn't real. SuicideMouse.avi. Back when jump scares were still fresh and trendy, Suicide Mouse really helped dominate the scene with its dark Disney aesthetics and low-quality piano playing in the background. Simply just Mickey Mouse walking along a city street before the video then cuts abruptly for several minutes. It then returns, playing loud audio and displaying distorted and corrupted imagery. This really paved the way for the future dark media and ARG/analog horror series on the internet when you really think about it now. Slender Man, an all-time classic, possibly the most well-known creepypasta on this iceberg. A mysterious creature stocked to the max with supernatural abilities. While his abilities fluctuate wildly, his appearance remains the same. A faceless humanoid figure with pale white skin, dressed in a black suit and tie. Tentacles are often displayed. He hunts children in forests, either murdering them or putting them into a daze so he could either draw more victims out or make the children murder for him. His intentions, while not entirely understood, are without a doubt evil. Starting out originally as just a Photoshop contest entry on the Something Awful forums, Slenderman has undoubtedly paved its way from internet horror story to legit cultural zeitgeist and urban legend, with countless books, movies, web series, and unfortunately real-life crimes that have been inspired by the tall, faceless man. Jeff the Killer. One of the pioneers of the early 2010s horror community. There are technically two stories to Jeff, both ending in the same result, a bleach-skinned maniac with a wretched smile. The original version is apparently a controversial one in the creepypasta community for being so poorly written. The image, while rumored to be a Photoshop picture of a suicide victim, has quite the mystery to it in itself. The original author states that it was just his face with a mask on, but there's speculation that this image has been appearing online since 2005, and may come from a Japanese movie. Fun fact, the Japanese movie displays this image with the caption, "Good night," which may have led to the Jeff the Killer's famous catchphrase, "Go to sleep," which he says before murdering you. The Rake. Dating back to 2005, a user created a 4chan thread simply saying, "Hey B, let's make a new monster." And voila, after many threads and many, many revisions, for example, the Rake was supposed to have three green eyes, have no mouth, and was originally nicknamed Operation Crawler. But a post to Something Awful forums in 2006 cemented its looks and its fame in internet history. The Rake is said to hunt people down in campgrounds, but also is said to stare at you while you sleep. Supposedly, it is an immortal being and was at one point a human. Lavender Town Syndrome. Lavender Town and its soundtrack originated from the original Pokemon games, but it holds a much darker history. Back in the 90s, when Pokemon Red and Green were released, it was reported that once reaching this town in the game, kids often felt ill, and sometimes would result in taking their own lives. Supposedly, the Lavender Town theme song had a frequency so high that only young preteens could hear, resulting in supposedly over 200 kids committing suicide. After this phenomena happened, the programmers went back and lowered the frequencies in the song, and no issues had been reported since. The Backrooms. Another 4chan origin creepypasta, this time coming from the X board. The theories on the Backrooms are endless, but the results are all the same. A randomly generated musty complex with a constant humming that sounds similar to old fluorescent lights. If you noclip into an area that sounds similar to this description, keep in mind that each backroom is different. Then, please, remain still, remain calm, and lastly, do not interact with anyone inside. They are not who they seem. Tiki Toby. Also known as Tobias Rogers, his backstory is full of sadness as he was born with half a dozen crippling mental illnesses, to which he was bullied relentlessly for. One day, similar to Jeff the Killer, Toby's mentality snaps and he murders his father with a knife. After a while, Tiki Toby, nicknamed Tiki because of his Tourette's, gets found by Slenderman and lives as a proxy to him, killing any target selected, often children. I do not like this creepypasta, it's poorly written, and the use of Slenderman as a crutch is just kind of weird, and also the Tourette's thing, it's kind of messed up, but yeah, moving on. Tails doll. It's as descriptive as it gets. A doll that looks like Tails from the Sonic series. While the Tails doll is a real canon creation in the Sonic universe, this one isn't necessarily on the same premise. In the Sonic universe, Tails doll was created as a bot to destroy New Megatropolis. But the creepypasta Tails doll, or as it's titled, the Tails doll curse, its purpose is one thing, and one thing only, bloodlust and homicide. The story goes is that a man picks up a rare copy of Sonic Racing, soon to discover his game isn't quite like the others. One night after completing the game, the father hears footsteps near his door. Thinking it's his son, he scolds him to go back to bed, but the footsteps don't stop. Finally, he opens the door, and Tails doll had come to life, covered in the blood of his son. It then says, "You are coming with me, forever." Yeah, it literally just ends like that. It's really fucking dumb. Eyeless Jack. Two brothers, Mitch and Edwin, lived together after Mitch's house was foreclosed. One night, Mitch wakes up to find he had a mysterious gash on his face. He decides to go to the hospital to have it checked out, only to have the doctor tell him more alarming news. He's had a kidney removed. Mitch returns home and at midnight, finds that he and Edwin aren't home alone. A blue-masked man stood over Mitch's bed, eyes hollowed out, dripping with black fluid. The man, known as Eyeless Jack, attempts to lunge at Mitch but fails. During this time, Mitch snaps a picture of Eyeless Jack and then makes a run for it, but Mitch falls while running away, leaving him unconscious. He wakes up in the hospital, seemingly fine. He returns home with his family to find that Edwin had been murdered, with organs spewing around. Near the corpse of his little brother, Mitch finds a kidney with a bite taken out of it. Smile Dog. Originally referred to as Smile.jpg, it's a haunted image that, once seen, can and will drive anyone insane enough to take their own lives. Once you have seen it, the image of its smile will be burned into your brain, unable to not see it no matter where you look. The image itself has been adapted to fit creepier and creepier standards, but the original will always remain disturbing and mysterious enough. Jane the Killer. Literally just Jeff the Killer, but as a woman. Her parents were murdered by Jeff, so she seeks vengeance in any way possible. After being pumped with what is only known as liquid hate, she gains supernatural abilities. For example, being able to run faster than a track athlete on steroids. Literally, the words from her wiki. Anyway, her truest intent is to hunt Jeff down, but if she can murder his victims before him just to drive him insane, she'll do whatever it takes to cause him pure agony. Play with me. Turning up the graphic content here, fair warning, sexual assault is mentioned. If you would like to skip to the next entry, I will leave a timestamp on the screen right now. This story is about a young girl named Sally, who was only 12 years old when she became a victim to her Uncle Johnny. She had tried to tell her parents about what Uncle Johnny was doing to her, but they didn't quite understand what she meant when she said she didn't want to play his games. Overhearing this, Johnny flew into a rage and excused him and Sally from the house, saying that they were heading to the store for groceries. Instead, Johnny drove into a park, where he assaulted Sally again, and then brutally murdered her with a rock. Because of this, her uncle was arrested and sent to prison. But the spirit of Sally was not done just yet. Becoming a ghost, she attacked her uncle in prison, scaring him to death. Ever since then, Sally haunts the house that she grew up in. I'm a search and rescue officer. A very lengthy 8-part story detailing what actually goes on in the United States Forest Parks. Since this story alone has many, many different tales inside of it, it's really hard to go into the basics of the story. So I'll just give you a hint. There's stairs. Okay, that's all you get. Dead Bart. An old internet theory states that there is an episode of The Simpsons named Dead Bart, production titled as 7G06, which was later used for the episode Moaning Lisa. The episode is rumored to cause drastic emotional reactions from anyone who was a part of the team when this episode was made. It is said that if you bring it up, any of the cast members will refuse to discuss the matter of the episode, and will do whatever it takes to prevent you from talking to Matt Groening, the creator of The Simpsons. Eventually though, the person in the story was capable of getting Matt by himself and asking him directly. Matt reacted out of fear and rage, and wrote down a URL, asking never to talk about this again. The URL contained a deadly computer virus, but the file on it was luckily backed up. When opened, the file contained the Dead Bart episode. This episode starts off with Bart dying from falling out of a plane, and after this, it displays graphic, horrific experimental visuals and audio throughout the second and third act. The episode ends in a cemetery showing the tombstones of every single person who had worked on The Simpsons, even guest stars, or even guest stars who hadn't appeared on The Simpsons at that time. Local 58, a web series / ARG that broadcasts news of a town that is overruled by some eldritch monstrosity. It would become one of the top trendsetters for what would eventually be called analog horror. Although the plot doesn't seem to be continuous, the theme remains clear. There's something in the sky. Pets Cop, another ARG that made its debut on YouTube. It's a game that seems like it would be just another YouTube Let's Play series, but in fact, it holds much darker secrets. The main character, Paul, finds the game Pets Cop and begins to explore around. At first, it looks to be an incomplete game, but the physical copy he was given had a note that led him to finding secret levels and maps in the game. As his exploration deepens, he discovers that Pets Cop wasn't meant to be played by the general public. It was targeted for specifically one horrific person. Finally, Paul ends up disappearing altogether, but his Let's Play series continues on. Someone else wants you to see this game, not just Paul. Squidward Suicide, another example of lost media just like Dead Bart. It is also referred to as Red Mist. The story goes that an intern at Nickelodeon opened up about an episode of SpongeBob SquarePants, where they were supposed to be watching one episode, but somehow ended up watching this one instead. At first they thought it was a morbid adult joke from the animators, but as the episode rolled through, the audio and visuals became increasingly more disturbing. Finally, the end scene displays Squidward, blood running out of his eyes, holding a shotgun to his head. You can hear chance of people screaming "do it" over and over before finally. NES Godzilla. The story is written from the perspective of Zachary, a young adult who had received several NES cartridges from a friend. After loading the Godzilla Monster of Monsters game, he notices that there are a number of new strange kaijus that he didn't remember from his childhood. However, his initial joy at discovering what seems to be a modified version of the game quickly turns to fear as he is encountered by Red, also known as the Hell Beast, who begins to haunt Zachary as he plays. He soon realizes that Red isn't just a modification, but rather a demon spirit that's bent on murdering. Throughout his journaled experiences, he discovers that his deceased girlfriend Melissa was murdered by Red before the game fell into Zachary's possession. Red is finally defeated, when all seems impossible, by a brand new angelic entity, who Zachary soon learns is Melissa herself. The lore of this creepypasta is very long, and YouTuber Billy Styler did an amazing deep dive on both the original creepypasta and its sequel itself that you should check out. The SCP Foundation, a top secret organization that was created to lock up and study brand new paranormal beings. These paranormal beings range anywhere from evil staircases all the way to evil plague doctors and more. The range of monsters seems almost infinite, and it's the Foundation's job to discover exactly what every monster does, and how to stop Ben Drowned. This story actually follows three different plot points that chain together. While the story itself is legendary, it is also vastly confusing to summarize without turning it into its own individual video. Ben Drowned follows the story of Jad Usable, a college student who discovers a malevolent entity called Ben lying dormant within a copy of Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask. After posting his findings on 4chan, Jad Usable disappears and Ben is then seemingly released onto the internet. After this, readers stumble upon the Moon Children, a cult with dark secrets and ties to Ben's origin. Throughout the years, various players and characters alike, such as Rosa, Alex, and Sarah, have fought to uncover the truth behind a child's murder, the people responsible, and the disappearance of anyone who stands in their way. The first plot, known as the Haunted Cartridge arc, starts with the main character, Jad Usable, playing Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask. There he comes across what he suspects to be a modified save file, so he uploads some clips to his YouTube channel. This is when we begin to learn about Ben, the corrupted ghost file in the game. It's said to haunt Jad Usable even when he turns off the game, and it only grows in power from here on out. This plot ends with Ben breaking free from his containment via using a Word document that the readers accidentally downloaded, hinting that Ben is now free all because of you. The second plot, referred to as the Moon Children arc, begins once Jad Usable abandons his YouTube channel. Ben begins to use the channel as a proxy of communication by uploading random additional clips, referring the viewers to a secret website called youshouldn'thavedonethat.net. There, we begin to learn about a cult called the Moon Children, who use the Elegy of Emptiness as their icon. This is a hint towards the first arc where Jad Usable stated he can turn into the Elegy of Emptiness inside the game. New characters are introduced, such as Ifrit and Ryukaki. Ifrit ends up mysteriously disappearing, and Ben posts song lyrics as a way to state it was he who made Ifrit disappear. Plot ends with users finding secret files on youshouldn'thavedonethat.net, linking to Ben's death, an audio file of someone drowning. The third plot, known as the Awakening arc, simply ties together all the previous plot points and arcs. Sarah, a new character, discovers that the cartridge originally owned by Jad Usable is actually filled with the souls of the dead, who are being tormented for eternity. She discovers how to defeat this evil curse in the end, by freeing all of the tormented souls. So, she performs the ultimate sacrifice and frees everyone inside the game. Unfortunately, this costs Sarah a heavy toll, but it's unsure of what exactly happened to her. Ben is then healed, going from an evil tyrant spirit to an NPC playing as a Link substitute. Anything post-Awakening arc is stated to either be non-canonical or simply supplemental value to the original arcs. I just want to state that, again, Ben Drowned is a very lengthy story with multiple sources of media providing in-depth lore, but this has simply just been the first tier on the iceberg, and I've already spent a lot of time broadly summarizing the story. We've got some more digging to do. Starting off Tier 2, we have Candle Cove. A group of users discuss an unusual kids show titled Candle Cove that they all remember watching growing up. As they reminisce about the show, they begin to ask if any others remember more disturbing scenes from the show, such as Skin Taker the Pirate, a pirate who's dressed in children's skin. Eventually, the user finally decides to ask his mom about the TV show, only for her to say that every time Candle Cove came on, it was just static on the screen. 1999. Also known as Mr. Bear's Cellar, a story focused around a Canadian TV channel called Caledon Local 21 that broadcasted a children's television show known as Mr. Bear's Cellar. It starts off innocent, albeit a little strange, with a man dressed as a cartoon bear. He'd often invite kids to his cellar so that they could play, and by the end of Mr. Bear's Cellar, he had 16 victims, all children and teenagers. As the main character watched the last episode, he could only watch as Mr. Bear dumped the kids' still living bodies into a deep pit and lit them on fire. The Rugrats Theory. A pretty popular theory that goes on to state that all the kids in the show were merely figments of Angelica's imagination, as she begins to lose her sanity to schizophrenia at a young age. The character's actual lore is as follows. Angelica's actual mother died of an overdose shortly after Angelica was born. Her father married a successful, money-hungry woman that Angelica obsessed over. Chucky didn't exist, nor did he have a mother, because both him and his mom died in a car crash, hence why Chucky's father was such a mess. Tommy was a stillborn, and that's why his father was always in the basement making toys for his son who he'd never meet. The DeVilles had an abortion before the gender was confirmed, so Angelica created twins in her mind since she didn't know what the gender was. Dill was the only one who was actually real, but because of Angelica's behavioral issues, and also thinking that he was simply just another imaginative being, she'd beat Dill for not listening to her. But one day, she beat him too hard. So hard, he was pronounced mentally incapacitated. Due to this guilt, Angelica took up hard narcotics until she overdosed as a teenager, a fate similar to her mother's. The show Rugrats would then be made by Susie, Angelica's only friend, in hopes of showing everyone that Angelica was simply a happy girl, trapped in her own mind. The Smiling Man, a story written by a person who describes their experiences of going for a late night walk. What was supposed to be something to clear his mind ended up becoming a night to never forget, when a tall man danced wildly on the sidewalks. No one else was around to witness this, just him and this dancing fellow. But as he crossed the street, he began being followed by this loosely limbed being, who wore a massive grin on his face the whole time. The experience doesn't get too drastic, but he recalls at the end that the smiling man didn't look drunk. He didn't look high. He looked completely and utterly insane. The Expressionless, also referred to as I Am God. A tale that describes a woman coming into a hospital wearing only a blood-covered nightgown. But the staff were more focused on something else. This woman didn't look human, but more of a walking, breathing mannequin. She peacefully allowed the staff to sit her on the bed and even let them restrain her until the authorities would arrive. But when they attempted to sedate her, the mannequin began to flail wildly, her body floating off the bed. She finally looked over at one doctor, and for the first time, she smiled, her mouth full of dagger-like teeth. She attacked and brutally murdered the majority of the staff. The male doctor asked her what she was, and she simply responded, "I am God." No End House. The writer describes disturbing, horrific troubles that he went through in a haunted house building to win an award of $500. But when he gets home, he soon discovers that the game isn't quite ever going to end. Zaugo. Also known as He Comes, Zaugo is an ancient evil entity which does not appear to have a physical appearance. Although the author states Zaugo is not of Lovecraftian inspiration, it's not hard to pair Zaugo with the premise of incomprehensible terrors. To experience Zaugo is to experience insanity, and even death. Zaugo is the end times. Zaugo denies fate, its presence questioning fate. Zaugo can show up in any form of reality, but often displays itself in text-based documents and popular internet memes. You will know when you're in the presence of Zaugo when the text on your screen begins to glitch and stretch across the screen, but it doesn't matter what you do next. It's too late. Anansi's Goatman Story. Anansi's Goatman Story is a classic 4chan creepypasta from 2013, where a user talks about their camping trip with their cousins. The campers realize that there is an additional person with them that none of them know. They begin to experience a foul odor that can be described as a horrid smell that's often described as rotting meat, vomit, and copper. Once spotted in its human form, the Goatman's shoulders will begin twitching, almost like it's laughing, but it doesn't make a sound. If it blends in with your group long enough, it can mimic voices to lure you out. The story ends with the campers discovering that the Goatman had been in their group since they had arrived. Abandoned by Disney. A user claims that he knows the truth behind why Disney had stopped working on Treasure Island, and that they're hiding the truth. If you didn't know, Disney had blown over $30 million to make a resort in which they ended up completely abandoning. Speculation is that they had trouble shipping out to the island and they were also blaming foreigners for being lazy. But according to OP, the real reason was because there was something on that island. Some sort of dark, paranormal force that would corrupt your mind and result in gruesome endings. Disney didn't close this down because of the petty issues, no. They closed it down because there was something there that they didn't want anyone to know about. Every copy of Mario 64 is personalized. Conspiracy theorists recall false memories from childhood regarding Super Mario 64, where they describe events or locations in Super Mario 64 that aren't found on actual copies. The theory then claims that Mario 64 had an AI shape the game to fit each gamer's playstyle, hence why there's so many unique memories. A post on 4chan ends by saying, "Have you ever played someone else's copy of Mario 64? Have you ever felt like there was something just a little bit off? That's why. That's how." Gateway of the Mind. A classic creepypasta story that tells of an experiment gone wrong. The experiment consisted of a group of scientists attempting to find and speak with God. They do this by removing a man's five senses, so no taste, touch, sight, smell, or hearing. He is left entirely by himself. They do this because they believe that the senses interfere with the connection to God. As time goes by, the man starts hallucinating and begins talking to ghosts, before finally going insane from lack of stimulation. At the end of the story, he infamously says, "I have spoken to God, and he has abandoned us." Antram. A once wholesome father-son bond is brutally ripped apart when the dad brings home a robot. The robot, although it couldn't speak, seems to be proof of sentient intelligence, as it would mimic the father and son's action. But one day, Antran would begin to get jealous of the son. It would start with a pinch here and a bruise appearing there. Until one night, the son wakes his father up. Through a raspy, shaky voice, he says, "Antran keeps looking at me at the end of the bed. The abuse only increases until one night, the father is awoken by blood-curdling screams. He runs into his son's room to find that both Antran and his son have disappeared into the night, never to be seen again. Mirena Mordegard Glesgord. There is a video on YouTube named Mirena Mordegard Glesgord. If you search this, you will find nothing. The few times you find something, you will see a 20-second video of a man staring intently at you, expressionless, and then grinning for the last 2 seconds. YouTube had removed the original video off its site after over 150 people had supposedly viciously removed their own eyes and mailed the eyeballs to YouTube's headquarters. Other reports of suicide and or suicidal tendencies come from this video, along with victims supposedly carving strange, indecipherable messages into their arms and bodies. The person who uploaded the original video has never been found, his IP address simply turning up non-existent. Penpal. This story is equal in length to I'm a Search and Rescue Officer, and split up into 6 different chapters. Footsteps, balloons, boxes, maps, screens, and friends. It's quite difficult to summarize this powerfully well-written story. It begins off with creepy, almost paranormal happenings, and ends with what I can only describe as heart-wrenching. Each chapter consists of bone-chilling plot twists, coming from the main character as he recalled his childhood, only to find out that he and his former best friend had been victims to a deranged stalker.
Lost Episodes. This isn't a specific creepypasta, but actually a subgenre of creepypastas themselves. I've mentioned Squidward Suicide and Dead Bart already, which fall under the subgenre of Lost Episodes. At the time of this recording, there are currently 42 Lost Episode creepypastas on the Creepypasta Wiki, and many more that have either been lost to time or are hidden somewhere else on the internet. Polybius. An alleged real-life arcade machine from the 80s that is supposedly haunted. Players would report hearing a woman crying after playing it, seeing deformed faces in their peripheral, have terrible nightmares, and would even physically cause them to feel sick. According to an owner of an arcade at the time, men in suits would come in to collect reports from the game's database. Because of this, it is speculated that it was a government-created machine ready to test on the public. Its exact purpose remains unknown. Pokemon Creepy Black. While there is a creepypasta called Pokemon Black, the iceberg specifically lists Pokemon Creepy Black. Pokemon Creepy Black was a fan-made ROM based off the Pokemon Black creepypasta, a story about an avid collector discovering a rare Pokemon game, but this rare game ends up being haunted by a malevolent spirit. However, Pokemon Creepy Black is a very strange Pokemon hack based on the original Fire Red version. Unlike your everyday Pokemon hack, this one revolves around the creepypasta of Pokemon. The game hides itself as an original Pokemon Fire Red version, but has some weird instances that will freak you out. For example, upon starting the game, you will see a ghost-type Pokemon that will suddenly appear in your party, aka, you don't choose the ghost, it chooses you. When using ghost Pokemon, there will only be one move, Curse. If you are to use this move, then it literally kills the opponent's Pokemon.
Mario. Mario, just like Pokemon Black, is based on a hacked version of an original video game title. The story begins with our protagonist, Adam, downloading a Super Mario World ROM hack from SNW Central, a very real ROM hacking site that hosts several different hacks for the original Super Mario World. The hack itself is simply titled Mario, and contains a text document only containing the words Find Me, over and over amongst more unreadable text. Upon starting up the ROM, Adam is greeted by the title screen simply titled Mario in all capital letters. Starting up the game, things immediately begin to feel off. Textbox dialogue from the original game has now been replaced, conveying a much darker story. As these text boxes continue to pop up throughout the hack, Adam begins to piece together that Mario is the antagonist of the story rather than the hero. Playing the actual game itself, multiple aspects are changed. Level titles are different, dragon coins cannot be picked up, there are no enemies, and even stranger text boxes begin to appear. After a while, Adam defeats the first boss, Iggy, and Mario saves the egg and blows up the castle like usual. Only this time, possibly the most disturbing dialogue of the story appears during the cutscene detailing what appears to be a murder victim, stating, Victim 1. Eyeballs were unable to be found. The victim was found lying on her carpet. Causes of death unknown. Hand marks with unidentifiable fingerprints were found all over the corpse. The story only continued to grow stranger from there until Adam eventually stopped playing the ROM and posted his findings to the SMW Central forum. It was there another user became interested in the text document at the beginning of the story. Upon converting the text document to an image format, the user discovered this image. Many theories have popped up about what this image may be as well as its origins, with several users
viewers and readers believing that this may be victim one mentioned in the story. The strangest security tape I've ever seen. A creepypasta written and originally posted to the No Sleep subreddit in May 2012, an unnamed convenience store worker is given the store's security tapes by his boss and told to watch them to determine if his creepy coworker Jeremy is stealing gallons of oil. But after a short while, he notices that things start to repeat themselves around there, and finding that Jeremy doesn't show up to work the next day, he and his boss make plans to call the police. Again, and again, and again. And things only get worse from there, with the story ending as the OP describes how tomorrow he'll begin working with a new coworker named Jeremy, showing that the OP seems to be stuck in some sort of time loop. Buried alive model. In Pokemon Red and Green, specifically in the Lavender Town Tower, it was rumored that you were supposed to fight a boss at the end of the tower, this boss being a reanimated human corpse. Once you arrive at this stage, Buried Alive, also referred to as the Berry Man, will greet you saying, "You're here. I'm trapped. And I'm lonely. So very lonely. Won't you join me?" When you enter into the duel, it'll bring out a Muk, a Gengar, and two white hands, rumored to be its very own hands, with skin peeling away, revealing flesh and tendon. If you defeat the Berryman, your game will instantly freeze. But if you lose, then the Berryman proclaims, finally, fresh meat, before dragging your character into the ground and devouring you. Marble Hornets. An ARG that was created almost directly after the first Slenderman post on Something Awful. The series would go on to become affiliated hand-in-hand with the Slenderman lore, but since we already went over Slenderman, there isn't much summarizing to be done. Think of the original Slenderman game, but as a really good YouTube web series. Unfortunately, it was adapted into a movie in 2015 and failed miserably. Something about creepypastas becoming movies is just such a cursed concept. The Puppeteer. The Puppeteer is a story about a vengeful spirit who feeds on the energy of the depressed and vulnerable. He targets the emotionally fragile, using them for his own gain and power. He will harass a victim, manipulating them into believing that there is no way from escaping life's torment. The Puppeteer feasts once the victim decides that death is the only option left. But he wasn't always this way. The Puppeteer used to be just a normal teenage boy, until he was left devastated from a tragic heartbreak. He took his own life via suicide, but his emotionally charged spirit still lingers, attaching to anyone who felt the same way he did. Plankton Got Served, also known as One Course Meal, another creepypasta that falls under the Lost Episode subgenre, where Plankton from SpongeBob SquarePants reveals that he has a fear of whales, due to his ancestors being eaten by whales. Mr. Krabs uses this to his advantage to scare Plankton at every chance possible. Mr. Krabs dresses up as his daughter Pearl, a whale, and sneaks up on Plankton constantly. Finally, Plankton has enough and decides that suicide is his only answer. However, the episode was altered and SpongeBob comes along to save the day in the official version. But in the original episode, Plankton carries on with his plan and gets killed by a bus. The scene ends with Plankton getting called down into a black pit from his ancestors, resembling some metaphor for hell. Mr. Widemouth. A story about a creature that resembles a Furby toy, although he remarks that he is better than one. He repeatedly attempts to coax the narrator into engaging in violent or self-injurious behavior, and is heavily implied to have caused the deaths of numerous children this way. He often tries to get the main character to injure himself by either juggling knives or by convincing him that there is a trampoline outside his window. Eventually, Mr. Widemouth shows him a trail, saying he takes all of his friends down this path, but the main character isn't quite ready. The main character moves 2 weeks later, preventing Mr. Widemouth from successfully killing him. Jason the Toymaker, once a human named Jason Meyer, has now become a creature with human features who loves building and inventing toys. He displays himself as a perfect friend, but deep down, he's a possessive control freak who will kill anyone he perceives as standing in the way of his goal. He often grooms his female victims into perceiving him as perfect, asking them if they'd stay with him forever. Unfortunately, his idea of forever is a bit different. Happy Appy. A lengthy six-story saga about an old kids' show mascot named Happy Appy. It follows a long series of blog posts describing the show and its episodes before it was removed from air for displaying disturbing content. Similar to previous lengthy creepypastas, it's hard to summarize this since there just isn't one specific plot. It's a compilation of creepy, weird, and sometimes disturbing mini-episodes that were rumored to be produced for Nickelodeon. And there you have it, tiers 1 and 2 of the Creepypasta Iceberg. I was originally going to make this one lock video, but with working on other projects for this channel, as well as working full time, I have decided to release this as a 3-part series, and then another bonus video shortly after the finale. With that being said, I hope you all enjoyed the video and had fun watching. If you like my content, be sure to check out some of my other videos on the channel where I cover everything from weird media and music I like, internet mysteries, and other creepy or strange content. If you like what I do, be sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and check out my Patreon as well if you'd like to further support the work I do. This has been Yoshimi, and have a good night.